Welcome, y'all out there. We are here together, the Switch for Good podcast. I'm Dotsie Bausch, and this is Alexandra Paul, who y'all know. And gosh, I have something kind of serious to talk about. I was in a happy, flippant mood a moment ago, but so I just want to alert the public, alert people about this subject matter that I've been involved in working on over the last, about 3 weeks. And this is kind of one of those fringe things that you don't, you wouldn't actively think is taking place. We are killing about 2 million kangaroos a year in the brushlands of Australia for shoes, specifically Nike and Adidas soccer shoes. And as we all know, millions of dollars poured into Australia over the course of their brush fires to save the koalas and the kangaroos, right? And so many of them then went to sanctuary, got rehabilitated if they were burned and other scenarios that were happening to their families and were, had a safe place to be. And now, currently, they are releasing many of them back into the wild, only to be shot in the middle of the night for shoes. There is a law that if they shoot a mother and she has a joey, that they have to club the joey. The reasons are millionfold, and it doesn't make any sense because it doesn't make any sense because none of it makes any sense. But
they have to they have to club instead of shoot. So, I mean, is that sort of the same way they club the seals? No. Because what do they do with the joey? They just don't want the joey to be without a mother, right?
Right.
So they think they're being, what, kind?
No, I just say, I'm sure it doesn't fit. Our guest can probably share maybe some of the reasons that she thinks behind. They don't give a reason, first of all, right? That's just what they do. I'm imagining that the reason is they don't want the starving joeys running around, and then they're going to have more issues with people being mad that this is happening. It's another way for it to kind of get out that this is what's taking place. So alongside the Center for Humane Economy, five of us Olympians have been working on this problem from two sides. One of the problems is that it's being made for, you know, the skin is being used for shoes and you don't need it. We have all this incredible synthetics out there, incredible synthetic leathers. We've had a couple guests on who are making cactus leather and banana leather and pineapple leather. Not necessary. You can still get a good form-fitting, flexible, but strong shoe made from synthetics or plants, right? It doesn't have to be from animals. And so standing up saying, calling on Nike, we sent a letter to Nike last week calling on their CEO to stop this practice. The second problem is it is actually banned in the state of California, right, to buy anything that has a kangaroo leather. But multiple times different stores have been caught selling it anyway. So that's kind of the second issue. So if people care about this, if this is something that, you know, enrages them, enrages you guys that are listening, you can go to kangaroosarenotshoes.org. You can read the athlete's letter to Nike. You can get involved. You can speak up. You can share. You can email if you want to help. Maybe if you're in Australia, because we do have a fair amount of listeners from Australia, you would be especially interested in getting involved with this. So I wanted to put it out there so that people are aware. And then, you know, maybe even more importantly than any of it is to not buy these shoes because we just don't know. And this is the craziest part. It's not even for the leather that is around the foot. For most of the Nike shoes, it's for the cleats. Yeah, that's where they use the skins are for the cleats, not even for. So it's just.
I thought cleats were rubber.
They should be. That would be a good idea. I'll just say you're the one that thought of that. I have had cycling shoes with the cleats because we still on mountain bike shoes you still kind of have cleats that, you know, make it so you can walk, you know, when you get off the mountain bike. Exactly. And they work fine. They're made of rubber and plastics. Do a great job. So I'm sure if we had a soccer player on the show, they would really be able to, you know, explain in depth. I mean, the cleats are much more important in soccer than they are in cycling because we don't walk in cycling. It is for the bike to be on the bike. But I remember when I first started cycling, there was an Australian company called Karnak that was It was all kangaroo leather shoes. And back then, I mean, I didn't know anything. I didn't think anything about it. Everyone was just, oh, they mold so well. They feel so good. They form to your foot. They're so strong. They're so flexible. All the things that you really need a high performance cycling shoe to be. I was like, oh, okay. Well, that you just, oh, just, you know, I remember that headspace where it was just like, whoop, like, oh, all right. Well, I guess that's what they're going to have then. So, you know, and mine were cow leather. I mean, my Shimano shoes, you know, it was like, okay, this is just what they're made of. They still don't have a really good high-end cycling shoe that is made out of synthetics, but they do in this, soccer's the largest sport in the world. And they do now for soccer. It's completely unnecessary. Even if you couldn't find it, it's unnecessary. I mean, I would, you know, cycle just barefoot now is what would have to happen, I guess, if I couldn't get the right shoe. But anyway, so people can...
Give us the website again.
Yeah, kangaroosarenotshoes.org.
Great. Thank you so much, Dotsie, for your work on this. We have someone on the show who has done more for animals than anybody really ever, I think. She's devoted her life and the last 40 years to animals. She's also a heroine of mine.
Might as well.
She is the amazing Ingrid Newkirk. She's the co-founder and president of the largest animal rights organization in the world, PETA. People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals, which you and I were talking about earlier, which is actually called, we decided that it was a genericization, which means that, you know, when you say, could you hand me a Kleenex? What you really mean is a facial tissue, but we say Kleenex, or could you Xerox that? It means you want to copy it, but you use the brand name because the brand name is so ubiquitous. Mm-hmm. Well, PETA has become basically a genericization of animal rights, you know, because you and I are PETA people when we're out there on the streets. They're just PETA people. So thank
proud
you.
Of it.
And yeah, exactly. So she really helped animal rights become mainstream. And she's not afraid of making us all uncomfortable and doing what it takes to wake people up to what's going on with animals. She's written 10 books, and we're going to talk about her latest book, Animal Kind, today. She's really just a force and a fount of knowledge of all things animals and how we can treat them better and why we should. So, Ingrid Newkirk, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Well, thank you very much for having me. You're very, very kind. And I wouldn't have been able to do anything at all if everybody else hadn't chipped in and it hadn't struck a chord with them and they hadn't thought, aha, yes, I believe that, or I can do that, or glad to know that, let me get cracking. So thank you very much. And I don't mean to make people uncomfortable. It's just that we do an awful lot of things that we shouldn't do, and sometimes we haven't a clue that we do them. So we have to say, hang on a minute, do something else.
Do something else. No, I have to do a quick fangirl moment.
Okay,
that I didn't tell you about. So at the Mercy for Animals Circle V, the first one, so the one that was before you and I hung out, so this might have been 4 years ago, I was speaking on a little athlete panel thing, and Ingrid was on like the Legends panel before me. And I don't think we still have ever met in person. We haven't. I would remember. So she comes off stage and is just leaving, right? And I'm coming on and I pass by her. And she's like, oh, my gosh, that is the loveliest dress I've ever seen. And I was like, I didn't even say anything. I mean, I was... Ingrid just said my dress was awesome. Oh my God. I don't even know if I can get on the stage now. Total fangirl moment. I just went, thanks. I should have stopped and been a big girl and been like, hi, nice to meet you. But I just couldn't even do anything. So yeah, there's my fangirl moment. What's yours? You have one.
I have always adored her. My brother knew her before I did. She has been a huge force in our family and just a real guiding light. And I will tell you, actually, Ingrid, when I was 12, I went to confirmation class and I learned this quote that really stuck with me. And I thought, that's going to be my mantra. And it was, when in doubt, do what Jesus would do, the kindest thing. And then as I got older, I lost any sense of religion or I admire Jesus as a person, but I changed the quote to, when in doubt, do the kindest thing. And then I saw a quote of yours, which was, be kind, be kind, be kind. And I decided to adopt that as my sort of mantra because it was more concise than mine.
Well, I can't take credit for that. It was John Galsworthy who actually said that. And he said the three things that are important in life are the first, to be kind, the second, to be kind, and the third, to be kind. And to me, that sums it all up, because if you can live by that, you got it made. I mean, the Dalai Lama said he didn't care if you had any religion or none. The best religion of all is kindness. And it is. It goes across all the spectrums of everything.
And your new book actually also has that word in it, animal kind. And it's a really, really special book because it teaches us that animals have their own... Humans are so... We measure everything against our own standards of quote intelligence. So if a being cannot read, then we think, oh, they're not as good as us, mm-hmm. even if they can run 10 times faster than us. And Ingrid's book is so beautiful at showing the amazing things that animals can do.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Because we want to go into the book and then we're going to go backwards some. But that's such a great point and just an overarching theme of, Ingrid, why do you think people are so fiercely uncomfortable with the uncomfortable? Because as you were saying, if we say somebody isn't as intelligent as we are, we say, oh, okay, whatever, they're lesser than. But we don't rape, kill, and murder them because they're less smart. We do that with animals and we say, oh, but they're not as intelligent. I mean, that's kind of people's main, you know, reason and defense. Why does it make people so uncomfortable to compare themselves to animals and maybe come out on the other side, which is, oh, wow, we are the same. Why is that so uncomfortable?
Well, we have raped and killed lots of other human beings that we thought were lesser than we are.
That's true.
We thought they were others. I mean, we've done terrible things. And at this moment, when we're looking at racial injustice issues so much under the microscope, your heart can break into 1,000 pieces for the things that have been done, especially perhaps to women who were routinely raped by master down on the plantation, and to the children sold away from their mothers and so on, and to actually buy and sell human beings as if they were commodities. And the things we've done to people with disabilities, to orphans, to you name it. So yes, we have done that. It's just we've been dragged kicking and screaming sometimes. Sometimes it's taken a war to get us to a point where we've stopped misbehaving in those abominable ways. So now I think people are so desperate always to build themselves up, and often at the expense of those others. So you build yourself up by putting someone else down. Mm. And I remember back in the 60s when we were marching for women's liberation, you know, the bra burners that we were, and some men were absolutely fearless, bold in saying, no, a woman's place is in the kitchen or the bedroom. And that women don't have the intelligence to do this, that, and the other, to pass the ERA. And they believed it. They put themselves above women. Women were others. So the same is true with the other animals. And when I wrote Animal Kind, there's obviously a double or treble meaning there, is that we are one animal among many, but it embarrasses us. We don't want to be lumped with the others. We want to be the godlike figures, and we want the others, the great orchestra of life, to be somewhere down there beneath us. And so we have to get over that vanity, if you will, and see ourselves as just one animal among many. We have many different talents and abilities. They can far outdo us in so many different spheres, but if you talk to the average human being, I mean, we say, oh, we can do this, we can do this. I can't put a man on the moon. I can't design an iPhone. I have no idea how Zoom or Skype works other than you press a button. So most of us are just getting through life and thinking about what is important to us. So are all the other animals. And they must pay such close attention to us because we dominate their world as well as our own. And they are dependent on us even for a drink of water, even not to be shot for a pair of shoes. So yes, I think we have to try to work on people not to be so afraid of others, not to wish to bully and cajole and dominate others. We need to keep moving along on this trajectory, and we'll get there if we keep nagging enough.
I like that.
What are some of the stories that about animals that you like to tell? I heard you on the Rich Roll podcast, which was an excellent interview, and you all talked about how birds are getting up earlier in the morning because of our noise pollution, and they and this is in the book. Mm-hmm. So they can communicate with each other. So they're adapting to our travesties. Non-human animals are amazing beings. And us humans are too.
I mean, there are a million stories, of course, because if you pay attention to animals, you find how extraordinary they are. And I think on Rich Roll, we talked about their communication abilities, their navigational abilities, the extraordinary ways they can find their way from one point to another, maybe 7,000 miles away, without a GPS, without anybody to guide them, without any extraordinary power, just by the position of the stars or the Earth's magnetic field. Or things we have no idea about whatsoever. They can actually detect low-frequency radio waves to navigate over thousands of miles. So we talked about all that. But to me, there is a sort of more elementary thing, is that just as we fumble our way through life and we have our feelings, I look at, there's an internet video of a raccoon mother, and she's at the highway, and there is a concrete barrier, and one of her infants has fallen over the barrier onto the road, just beside the barrier, and she has pushed herself all the way over, except her feet on the other end, trying to reach down, as any mother would, and pull him up. But behind her is her yearling child, you know, was born a year earlier, holding on to her legs so that she can stretch over. And all three of them are working on rescuing this child. And you see that with elephants where a child goes into a mud pit and all the herd, the matriarchs, come around and do what they can. There's one thing that really just spoke to me so much. It was so simple and yet so poignant. During the California fires, and I was watching television, and there was a fire coming to a ranch, and the ranch was shrouded in smoke, and the people had brought horse trailers onto the street, onto the roadway. You could see the blaze behind, and then the smoke, and then the roadway, and they were loading horses they had rescued into these trailers. One stallion makes your heart stop because he breaks away. He's about to go onto the trailer. He breaks away and he runs back down the road and he goes back into the farm that's shrouded in smoke. And you think, please, no, 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 no. He's heard a whinny. It's probably his wife, a mare. And you see him, he gets the mare and his child, the foal. And he gets them, turns them around, and leads them all the way back to the road and stands them by the trailer. And I always said, you know, if that were The Rock, it would be a Hollywood black blockbuster. Mm-hmm. But it's just a horse. But he had to think. He had to feel. He had to be empathetic. He had to brave. No, he had to rescue her and the baby.
Goodness gracious.
And people.
Uh-oh. This one is going to cry the whole rest of the time. This is, yep.
She's, you know, where? Kleenex. Yeah, I know. I'm terrible. I don't know. Ingrid, I don't know how you, I'm changing the subject a little bit, but how you keep going. You have such resilience to keep seeing such atrocities, but I think you also see the beauty too that happens in on Earth. But how do you not end up just so emotional that it gets in, just exhausts you?
I do cry a lot, Alexandra. I have to admit, I definitely cry a lot. And I cry about happy things sometimes because the contrast is so severe to me because of what I see in the videos from our investigators. And of course, I have enormous respect for them because they must stand there, talk about resilience. And it's not easy. They're not hard-hearted people. They're there because they care. And they have to stand and film pain and suffering and death and killing and not make a peep, not say anything, not intervene. That really takes guts because they've got their eye on the prize. And that is, if I don't give myself away and I get out of here with this footage, I can open eyes and hearts and minds, and people will stop the sorts of behaviors that have created the scenario I'm filming. So I do have a trick, though, and that is I look back, because you can look at the enormity of what we have to deal with, and it is beyond anything in all these different pursuits. But if you look back and you look historically at the gains for other movements, and you look at the gains for our own movement, 40 years ago when Peter started, 20 years ago, 10 years ago, so much has changed. Fur is dead. Ringling Brothers has closed up the circus tents. Experiments, we now have organs on a chip. Not to say there aren't all these other horrors, but boy, oh boy, because people have agitated, because they've pushed, because they've demanded, they've said, I want something different. I won't buy those kangaroo leather shoes. I won't buy any leather shoes. Then things have changed. So that perspective makes you know that everything you do today to agitate, to educate, is going to pay off.
I just wanted to read to our listeners my very, I think, my favorite part of the book to inspire them to go get it. It's just the best. I have it all marked up and all these like tags and stickers in here of places that I went back to more than once. But you were talking about navigation. And there's a chapter in the book called The Mysteries of Navigation. And it starts out with a quote from Ronald Lockley. And he says, how do animals find their way over apparently trackless country, through pathless forests, across empty deserts, over under featureless seas? Then do so, of course, without any visible compass, sextant, chronometer, or chart. And the chapter starts out to say that on a foggy night in Tobermory, Ontario, in May 2016, police responded to a distress call from a woman who had accidentally driven her Toyota into Lake Huron. After dutifully following directions from her GPS, she had taken a fateful turn onto a dock before plummeting into the murky waters below. Yes, she escaped unharmed. A cursory Google search displays countless stories of navigationally challenged drivers blindly following their GPS onto train platforms, into oceans, down cliffs, into golf course sand traps, even through living rooms, which is like, who's stupid now? But I am very, very, very directionally challenged. So I can relate to that. I just only hope that I would look up before I drove myself into the ocean because the GPS said take a right turn right here. But after that bit on humans and their brilliance, it goes into stories of a couple of different animals and their extraordinary navigational skills that they have while not using a GPS. And my very favorite was is this story on the tiny Arctic tern. And they sound like they are just minute. Like, I don't know if they're as
they're
small
4 ounces.
As a hummingbird. So, yes. Yeah, so, they're that tiny. Think of a bird that tiny. So, they dart and zigzag more than 44,000 miles between Greenland and Antarctica each and every year. There you go. While the 4-ounce bird's path might seem inefficient, zigzagging, right? They hopscotch from continent to continent following precise air currents so they never have to fly into the wind. And as a cyclist, I can appreciate that. But as a human idiot, I'm always going into the wind. I'm never figuring out. Kirk and I was like, how do we figure out where the route is where we can have a tailwind the whole way? Well, if you were an Arctic tern, you would be able to figure that out. And it also says because they can live more than 30 years, Arctic terns end up flying the equivalent of 3 trips to the moon and back. Just like it's just such a great, cool story. Join us. Is that your favorite navigation story about an animal, or do you have another one?
There are so many. It's absurd. One of the things that fascinates me is how animals can smell the wind and they can smell the weather. And there are 2 stories in there. I'll try to get them right. One is about flamingos in Australia. There is a particular pond. It's called Lake Erie or something like that. And it only fills up once a year, and it's not regular. You don't know when it's going to fill up. It's a salt pond. And these flamingos can be thousands of miles away, and they know exactly the day that it fills up, and they all hightail it over to this pond. There's another story I really like about that, where these little warblers who, you know, you were talking about the tern, who is basically the weight of a muffin and the size of a muffin. These warblers are very small too, and they winter in a particular place. They migrate. And once they were in Tennessee, I think it was maybe 2014 or 2016, they were in Tennessee. And nobody thought anything was happening with the weather. Our meteorologists thought everything was just hunky-dory. These our little warblers decided to all up and fly down to across the Gulf of Mexico. And they'd never done that before. But just a day later, in came this devastating series of tornadoes that nobody had expected and just wiped out everywhere where they would have been. And after everything died down, back they came and set up on their nests again, as if not. Who told them? Where was this written? But they can, just the same with dogs, is that they can pick up scents that we can't detect. They can smell the weather. They know when storms are coming. They'll sometimes be on a migration and think, uh-oh, and turn around and go back and wait it out. Goodness. It's miraculous, really.
I can't even comprehend it.
So we've talked about the intelligence and the just innate intelligence of so many non-human animals. You also have a chapter, or you cover a lot of information on relationships between animals. Humans love to denigrate animals, that they don't have feelings, mm-hmm. that they can't really love or anything. And your book disproves that. And I love the comment that you made, something about the fact that swans have a 95% rate of staying together, but humans have like a what?
Lower than 50 now.
Yeah, 40% rate of staying together. So even our emotional capacity isn't as mature, if that's how you rate maturity, is in terms of long-term relationships, as so many other animals, especially a lot of birds.
Yeah, I mean, the animal who is closest to us perhaps is the chimpanzee, and they cheat. They have affairs behind their partner's back when they're not looking. But birds are tremendous. Most birds do mate for life. I say they marry their high school sweetheart, and they're with them at the end of their lives still. They could teach us a lot. My favorite bird, the swans, yes. I mean, all these birds, yes, they do. Geese are phenomenal parents and life mates. If a goose is shot, the other goose will come down and land beside them and guard them, even at risk of losing their own life. But my favorite is the pigeon, because, you know, people call them flying rats. I call mm-hmm. rats flightless pigeons.
We love them both.
The pigeons, they are super. They partner up for life, and they're very devoted to each other. They look after each other. but they're also fabulous parents. Each pigeon, male and female, makes milk in their crop to feed their baby. And they take absolute turns in feeding them and guarding them and looking after the nest, foraging and everything else. I don't know how they do it, but they do. And if you see a pigeon who has their bill, their beak, down another pigeon's beak, they could be kissing because they're very amorous, or they could be feeding their baby. You'll never know, but nobody should denigrate a pigeon. A pigeon is a marvelous, loyal, faithful, good, solid parenting bird.
Sounds like the males do 50% of the parenting, which is more than the average human does. So there you go. Chalk one up for the non-human animals again. Could talk to us about animal suffering. One of the justifications for the way that we've treated animals over the millicenturies is that they don't suffer the way that humans do. If you acknowledge that, an animal suffers, it's harder to hurt them. So talk to us about that.
Well, what's really extraordinary, I find, is that there have been so many research studies that show that animals feel, that they're pain averse, that even a little fish, there's been a study where if you give them pepper on certain pebbles or food, that they try to rub their mouth against something else to get rid of it, they'll never go near it again. We know about mice being given awful electric shocks to the point that they become helpless. It's called learned helplessness because they don't know anymore how to escape. They thought they knew how to escape the electrified grid in cage one and go live in cage two, and then the experimenters electrified cage two as well. So they become a urinating, shaking mess. Mm. We've done all these experiments to show empathy, to show suffering, and yet it doesn't inform the experimenters in the laboratory. Knowing that, they still willfully use animals as if they have no sentience, as if they're not sensitive. But we know from their own studies, you should also know from common sense, if you burn a monkey, a dog, a cow, a rat with a cigarette, and you burn me with a cigarette, we're all going to scream, we're all going to burn, we're all going to suffer. But we also know all these infant mother deprivation experiments that have carried on over the years. There's one 8 miles from here being conducted at the National Institutes of Health, where for almost 30 years, this woman, Elizabeth Murray, paid for with our tax money, takes monkeys, does something with their heads, puts them in a cage, and frightens them with rubber snakes and spiders to see how they react. Well, how do you think they react? Takes away the mothers from the babies and frightens the mothers with plastic snakes and spiders. And the babies go back to the mothers and shake the mothers who have been drugged to say, help me, help me. So we all know that animals suffer. It's a question of when are we going to stop causing them all this needless suffering. You know, if you couldn't have kangaroo shoes, you can decide at the end of the day, if you don't play soccer because it would cause suffering, then don't play soccer. So if someone says, oh, you've got to have these experiments, which is ludicrous given that we're spending billions and we're hurting millions of animals every single year. We don't even have a cure for the common cold. But if you want to buy that lie, then just decide, well, then we just don't need it. We'll just leave them in peace. There are others like us, and we are not entitled to abuse them, to confine them, to cage them, to burn them, to shock them, and so on. They're not ours.
And those are our tax dollars at work. I imagine the NIH funds a lot of basic science that asks these sort of ephemeral questions about if you take a baby away from his or her mother, how do they react? When you could actually just observe that in humans very easily, but it keeps these scientists
paid
exactly and busy. And you talk about that in your book in terms of this is what we've been doing, but there are solutions. the second half of your book, the first half of your book extols the amazing qualities of so many non-human animals. And the second half shows us how we don't have to make them suffer or imprison or captive, bother them anymore. And the most, I think the part that a lot of people haven't heard is the testing part and the science part, where you show that we now have alternatives to the old ways of testing drugs, for example.
Yeah, I think we never had the right to do what we have done to all sorts of populations, GIs who were given hallucinogenic drugs without their knowledge because they were expendable. They were just GIs. They were enlisted men. Who cares? Orphans, you know, traditionally, the Tuskegee experiments on syphilis with black men not being told, not being treated. We thought we could. Might doesn't make right. It shouldn't make right. But with animals, it still does in the laboratories. And I think it's mostly a question of nobody taps that experimenter on the shoulder and says, hey, Joe, you've been doing this for 40 years. What have you learned? But the other thing is, of course, we are in an age of technology. So we have high-speed computers now that we program with human data, not with mouse and rat and dog and monkey data, but with human data. We have whole human DNA on the internet. You know, we have organs on a chip, a lung, a heart, you name it, on a chip. You don't need what they used to call the patter of little feet in the laboratory, which is an enormous amount of suffering. But we are now taking slices of human brain in the petri dish and actually building scaffolding with them and creating a human brain. You know, when can we secure all these billions of dollars a year that our national government, the NIH and the NIMH, are throwing away on old-fashioned experiments that cause all this grief and putting it into state-of-the-art things where you can actually get results that apply to human beings?
How do we, if somebody says, maybe is listening to this and didn't really realize the extent of what's going on behind closed doors in laboratories, and yet they know how to take an action every day to stop the suffering for land farm animals by changing their diet. What can we do to stand up against what's going on in the laboratories as a single human being on a daily basis, or a week, whatever it might be, a weekly basis? Like how do we fight that in the same way that we're, or in a similar way, or in a different way? But how do we fight it the way that we are fighting not eating animals? Because that's like an action people can grasp easily.
Yeah, three times a day you can make that decision. You're right. Most people are never going to go into a laboratory. They're never going to see inside. One of the things that I always think is, we've always got campaigns where, like Skittles, we're knocking down one ghastly experiment after the other. So if you go to peta.org, and this isn't just a promotion, I mean, it's go there, see what is currently going on. For example, at the moment, there is a test we're going to knock out. We already have, Pfizer has knocked it out, universities have knocked it out. There are other drug companies still using it. To test depression drugs, and this is going to sound crackers because it is, for years and years and years, they've taken small animals, guinea pigs, mice, rats, dropped them into a solid-sided beaker of water and allowed them to swim for their lives. They think they're going to drown, so they're frantically swimming. And you see them, they'll dive to the bottom of the beaker trying to find a way out, and there isn't one. They'll try to scratch at the sides. There isn't a way out. And they just record at what point they give up. And this is supposed to tell us something about depression? So we've said, knock it out, stop it. Everyone can get involved in getting to those companies and saying no. Eli Lilly is one of the companies that still uses it. Tell them, get on their website, bombard them, do our action alerts, and one by one we'll knock them out. But also, Collar your representatives, even though we all know legislation is the hardest thing on earth to ever get passed. Make sure your representatives know there are bills before Congress now, and there can be bills, especially in progressive states like California, to ban certain tests on animals, experiments on animals that are shown to be completely cruel and wasteful. And get behind them. Go visit your representatives. Don't just write them or email them. Take a little time and go and sit with them and say, I vote and I want you to do this. And the more that we come out against the forces of the cage manufacturers, the feed producers for laboratory chow, all the other forces that make money from keeping animals in labs, we need to show our power. But there's always something you can do, and never buy a household product or a cosmetic, a personal care product that doesn't have that leaping bunny logo that means we did not test on animals, no animal ingredients.
You can download the app it's called Bunny Free, isn't it? And it's got a little bunny, and you can just, when you go in the store, if you're wondering, you want to buy something, you just put the name of the product in the app search bar, and they'll tell you whether, right there, PETA will tell you whether it's tested on animals or not.
Yeah, goes red or green. Red, don't buy it.
And then also, so important, tell the good companies that you're buying from them. Tell the bad companies why you're not. And I always say, take a picture of the label of what you did buy and send it to the company and say, I would have bought from you, but I didn't, because you still test on animals, or you still have collagen or hydrolyzed animal protein or something in your product.
I'm glad you brought collagen up, because I've had many people ask me what's wrong with it. Well, I know it's from an animal, and just knowing how they take from animals, I can only fathom what might go on behind closed doors to get collagen. But you probably know.
Well, all of these things, I mean, if you look at the label, you'll see all sorts of mysterious things that don't sound bad. Collagen is one of them, hydrolyzed animal protein. Those are two very big ones. But anything, if you ask yourself this simple question, do you think the animal was a volunteer? Do you think the animal voluntarily gave this up, whether it's lanolin from their fleece, whatever it is, beeswax, you name it, placenta you see in face creams, turtle oil. I mean, these animals need all that stuff. It's part of their physical self. And so it's the same as fur or leather or anything else. They didn't give it to you. It is not yours. Leave it alone. It doesn't belong to you. Do not steal. And so I always say, whatever it is, if it's somebody wants to put a parrot on your shoulder or have your picture taken with a tiger cub or put your feet in a fish pedicure tank, are the animals volunteers? No. So don't do it. Don't go there. Say no to it all.
Yeah. I want to note about the animal testing, because a lot of people feel like that we need to test on animals, and they might not know that even though we
to fight human diseases, cancer probably being the most
probably.
And to keep
humans
safe. Yeah.
And to know whether a drug is effective or a chemical is safe or a drug is safe. But it's actually holding back innovation. Because, yes, Ingrid talked about all of the new technologies that don't use animals, but currently the FDA mandates that when you bring a drug to market, you have to test it on two animals at least, and do a whole bunch, a battery of tests. And these animal tests are actually holding back progress, because companies that could make even more of these amazing alternatives aren't incentivized, because legally, animals still need to be used.
And when you say two animals, of course, you mean two species.
I'm sorry,
of
you're right.
And it may
two
be
species.
More than that. So they'll do hundreds, if not thousands, of small animals. And then they'll do hundreds, if not thousands, of dogs. And then they'll do hundreds of monkeys. So they're going through this. My friend's father got cancer, and he lived maybe 8 blocks from the National Institutes of Health Cancer Center, and they weren't interested in him going into a study. Well, my friend's father said, take me. You know, here I am. I'm going to die. And they said no, because they were busy in the basement with the mice and then the dogs and then the monkeys. And in the end, what have you got? Because a carcinogenic for a human animal is not necessarily one for a mouse. And a one for a mouse isn't necessarily one for a rat. There are so many physiological metabolic differences that it's rubbish. So one of my favorite long-time examples is for burn victims. What a terrible thing it is to have burns over a vast part of your body. And for years, all this money would go into blow-torching pigs and creating burns of various kinds, mostly in pigs because they have a similar skin to human skin. Enormous suffering, terrible things. If that money had been taken early on and put into more innovative research methods, we would have had cloned human skin, which we now have, years and years before we finally got it. And you can Federal Express cloned human skin and graft it onto a human body, and somebody who has massive burns can actually recover. But we lost all these people, in addition to all these pigs, because the money went there, because that's what we had always done. Mm-hmm. So when someone says, oh, we depend, no, you don't. Look at all the people who have innovation. Why is it private money that's going into innovation, and our tax money is being squandered on these old-fashioned animal experiments that don't get us anywhere, and as you said, Alexandra, hold us back? This is wrong, even if you don't care at all about animals.
What was your aha moment 40 years ago where you were just like, wait a minute, what is happening? And I want to maybe think about doing something about it.
Oh, Darcy, I was such a slow learner. It's incredibly embarrassing. I had my first fur coat when I was 19. I had a wild cat hat when I was a little girl. I always rode the donkeys or at the beach or the horse cart in Delhi because I loved animals. And I, with my father, I always say we basically ate our way through the animal kingdom. Yet I love dogs. I had grown up with a dog. I adored him, but I didn't connect the dots. And one by one, slow learner me, I had experiences that opened my eyes. And one of the first was a lobster. We were having a wonderful birthday party. I must have been 19 or 18. And they brought the lobsters to the table on a silver service. And they wiggled their antennae at me. And the waiter said, would you choose one, madam? And I chose one. And he said, broiled or boiled? I didn't know then that when you say broiled, which I did, they cut open the lobster's back alive, put in the butter, the salt, and the pepper, and slide them under the grill. So it didn't occur to me. We were drinking wine. It was lovely. The lobster came back to the table in bits. And I put one in my mouth, and something must have hit my subconscious because I burst into tears. You asked me if I ever cry. I cried. And I thought, I just killed this living being whose only method of communication was to wiggle his antennae at me. He couldn't speak, and I just didn't even register. And so that was when I stopped eating sea animals. And then one by one, I've had these other experiences that made me stop doing other things. It's very embarrassing.
It's not embarrassing. I grew up the exact same way, having horses and gerbils and hamsters and dogs and rabbits, and loved them so much. And, you know, I grew up in the South in Kentucky. I ate everything, and it, you know, for 35 years. And one question I had is I grew up saddlebred horseback riding. My dad's whole side of the family are thoroughbred racehorse trainers and owners. And back then, loving the horses that I rode, I would carry a whip. I would put on my spurs. And then I would go spend hours and hours literally snuggling with my saddlebred horses in their stall. My mom and dad would have to tear me away from the barn by 9 o'clock at night. You have to come home and sleep. Horses were so gentle and so loving and so aware. And of course, now I look back on all of that, in most of it, in horror. But what I wonder, and I feel like I'm always going to wonder, what we've done to dogs is what we've done to some horses. We've domesticated them in some way. And so they're not free to roam around and be horses anymore. I feel like we owe enrichment to those that we have enslaved, quote, domesticated, like I give my two Chihuahuas enrichment. And so when I think back on the horses, and when I go back to Kentucky to visit, which is quite often, and I see horses that are out to pasture, right? Very common in Lexington, right? A lot of the thoroughbred horses that, you know, they can't get big stud fees from are just gone for dog food. But sometimes they'll just let them out to pasture. And they look miserable because the first couple years of their life, I mean, you know, they were an athlete for the racehorses, 2-3 years, the saddlebred horses, you know, 6-8 years. And so I wonder, because I remember trail riding with my saddlebred horse in the winter, off season. We take the shoe, take their shoes off. I don't know what that was about, but they took their shoes off in the winter. And I would ride without a crop and without a whip and without spurs. And I felt this extreme joy myself. And whether I was placing that on the horse or not, I don't know. But I felt like that horse was having a pretty good experience in comparison to having to sit in a dark and lonely stall, because we've done this to them. So what are your thoughts and your explanation behind things like that, situations like that, as it specifically surrounds horses and enrichment? And if some of that enrichment, as they've already been trained to be ridden, to go on a pasture ride with your human?
Oh, well, I'm sure that they don't want to sit in a stall or stand in a stall all day. I mean, it's a box. To me, it's sort of like the dog who is kept in a crate. It's just a see-through box. You know, that's not what a living being wants. And they don't want to just be standing in a field with nothing to do. There was a wonderful story Alice Walker wrote called Am I Blue? And it's about someone putting a stallion with a mare. And they have a wonderful time. They nuzzle and they play and they run together and they come alive together. They have a relationship. And then, of course, when the deed is done, the stallion is removed. And the mare just goes back to standing in the field, looking out over the fence with nothing to do. And Alice Walker comes by once in a while and gives the mare an apple. And she says, you know, the mare has just lost her oomph. She's lost her will to live. But there are so many cruelties that are involved in the training of horses. The fact that we use all these accoutrements, bits and bridles and saddles and spurs and what have you. I mean, the whole racing world is just an atrocity. Yeah. The legal drugs, the illegal drugs, the way that they are kept, they're just things. And then, as you say, and as we've shown, so many of them end up being ground up for meat in Mexico, in France, in Canada, sent to Korea for meat. We followed them there. American thoroughbred racehorses who have won races are chucked out and go on these long journeys to Korea. And people say, oh, well, they've gone out to stud. If anybody's ever seen a stud farm, it's just a horror. It's not, you know, Bachelor City there. They're having a horrible time. And the mares. And then they end up as meat. But yes, if you have a horse, I always say to people, think about it. I mean, is their life really right to be in servitude? I know that in India, for example, where people use bullocks, they use steers as beasts of burden, and they take a pin and they make a hole in the septum, the bull's nose, and they put a rope through it, and they have that rope around them through their nose for their whole life. They're basically steered by it. when we rescue a bull and we take that nose rope out, the joy of just the removal of what was considered an ordinary training, restraining, what would be a bridle even, is that they lick their nose, they rub their faces, they, I'm liberated, is basically what they're saying. And so with horses, yes, we have to stop seeing them as stuff we have, accoutrements of our lifestyle. They're sensitive, they're intelligent. In Norway, I think I put in the book, there's a story of horses who have been trained, because they like intellectual stimulation like anybody else, they have been trained that if they're cold, they touch a symbol on the fence and someone puts a blanket on them. And if they're too hot, although how you can be too hot in Norway, I don't know, if you touch another symbol, they'll take the blanket off. So if you find that you can enrich their lives, please do.
Domestication is an issue where I think really where humans are completely blind, that we think it's okay to have a dog in our home and go to work all day, leave the dog in the house, walk the dog like three times a day, so which means, you know,
or once,
or yeah, making them hold their bladder, look, oh, they're fine, even though humans can't hold their bladder more than a few hours and it's uncomfortable, and then they go to sleep, and that's, the dog is supposed, is, I don't know, our standards are so low for how we treat animals, even the ones we love.
Yeah, absolutely. The ones we love, we are so thoughtless often. And now with COVID-19, and after 2 weeks, people were bored out of their skulls. They had watched everything on Netflix. They had emailed their friends. They didn't know what else to do anymore. They cooked everything they ever knew how to cook. And they were saying, well, what am I going to do? Well, the dog is usually at home while you're at work all day, every day. And to them, people are often a blur. They come home from work in the old days before COVID-19, change their clothes, go out to the movies, go out to dinner with a friend, go out somewhere. Makes me so angry, frankly. And I do always stop and say something. If I see someone dragging their dog, hurrying their dog down the road, even now when they have time, because your life isn't that important, that this wonderful excursion, it's not just go out and do your business. It's an excursion. You're outside, finally. No four walls. You can smell the internet on the bushes. You know who's been there, what health they're in, all these things. And people are just hurrying them along, or they're on their mobile phone, or they wear a prong, they put a pronged collar on them. Oh, put yeah. that on yourself. You know, and don't put your dog in a crate, this see-through box. If you value your couch more than your dog, or you can't clean your floor, or you haven't got time to housebreak that dog, what are you thinking of? That dog is not a toy or a prop or to match your drapes. That dog is a thinking individual. And when we say, be quiet, don't bark, stop digging, down, don't bother me, what are we thinking? They want a life. They want to talk. We talk all the time, and we listen to boxes that talk. They need to bark once in a while. And when they scratch at the door, they're telling you, excuse me, I need to go out. How basic is that? Or I can hear someone coming who you can't hear, and mm-hmm. I'm alerting you. So don't tell me, be quiet. You know, give them a break. Love them, respect them. No, they're not your fur babies. As nice as you may think that is, they're grown thinking individuals who honestly know 200 words of yours and you don't know one of theirs, because they pay attention to everything because they have to.
And we don't know one of theirs. That's exactly the point that makes you crazy, right? It's like there's so much complexity in communications in the non-human animal world. And another reason for people to get the book, because I loved learning about, especially the dolphins and the whales, and they're both so complex. We could never even comprehend probably one sound. We wouldn't even hear it, first of all.
Yeah, exactly. Ingrid, thank you so much for sharing so much rich information. Can you just tell us, I know that PETA is working on so many issues now. PETA's done so much to change, to bring animal rights mainstream instead of simply animal welfare, which right. just means, hey, they're warm in that box. You look at animals as they shouldn't be in that box at all. And they have rights and integrity, and they have their own lives. PETA is just such an amazing organization. I recommend everyone go to PETA.org. Tell us some of the campaigns that you're working on that you'd like our listeners to know.
Well, at the moment, we have two major campaigns that may interest listeners. One is coconuts. A lot of coconut products like coconut milk and so on are imported from Thailand. And if you see that it is, please be aware that a lot of monkeys are kept on chains, tied to an old tire, tied to an old box, and they are trained barbarically with force to climb the trees and bring down coconuts as many as 1,000 a day. That can all be mechanized. You can have human climbers. You don't need monkey slaves. And often they take the monkey's teeth out and so on. So we've got a lot of companies internationally that are no longer selling coconut milk products from Thailand. There are a couple of companies that are good. The list is on the internet, on our website, PETA.org. Please have a look and pressure the grocery stores and don't buy those kinds of things. The other is alpaca. You know, it became very trendy to have an alpaca coat or alpaca socks or what have you. And so we went to Peru, which provides most alpaca for the world. And we went to the biggest alpaca farm. And that video is on our website. Mm-hmm. These are gentle animals. They're prey animals. So when they're held down, they're sure they're going to die. They're slammed onto these tables. They're shorn very, very harshly. They're treated very roughly. They actually spit and they vomit out of fear. Some of them are pregnant, and that wool is processed and sent all over the world and ends up in stores. Anthropology is one of the stores that has not budged and will continue to sell alpaca unless enough people lean on them. Other companies have, like Gap and H&M, have come around. So those are two cases, but basically, I mean, as you know, and as you say, we are hoping that people will open their eyes to who animals are, how wonderful animals are, mm-hmm. and not be hierarchical about this great chain of being, but just be aware of the great orchestra of life and think of us as linked, not ranked, and think, how can I avoid anything that's stolen from an animal or anything an animal has to be killed for? Mm-hmm. And just don't do it. Don't go there.
I have a last question that isn't super comfortable, but I want to know how it makes you feel and what you think people are thinking. In the last, I don't know, 10 years or something, if somebody says, oh, are you vegan? There's people that'll say, oh, I'm vegan, but not the PETA kind. And I've been focusing on when people say that, I'll say I'm vegan and yes, the PETA kind. Get my eyes real big, look crazy. What is that? What does that communication say about them and the journey that they're on when they say, I'm vegan, but not the PETA kind?
I think it's all right. I thank you for saying I am the PETA kind, because that's the all-encompassing view that our hearts aren't small, that we have room enough to be decent and kind to everyone. But I think people get nervous and they think, oh, those PETA people, those PETA people, is that the next thing you know, it's a slippery slope and I'm not doing this, but now they're gonna make me not do that either. And I think, how wonderful is the slippery slope? You know, how fabulous it is that you learn something and you think, oh, I can make a compassionate choice. And then you learn another thing and you have the same option that you didn't even know you have. I mean, you can always say, the hell with it, I'm just going to be exploitive my whole life. Well, that's as far as I'm going. Mm-hmm. But I think they're just nervous that they will have to do a little bit more and a little bit more. And I say, don't be afraid of that. Embrace that. That's fantastic.
Because being a true trailblazer like you is always uncomfortable. So push through it. Push through it, you guys. Push through it. Become the feet of kind.
And it doesn't cost anything to use the voice you have, the typing fingers you have, the eyes you have. You know, we're so lucky. We are so lucky. I mean, human privilege. We've got it. We are 0.0001% or more. And the others don't have people say they don't have a voice. They have voices. We just don't listen. We don't hear and we don't understand, but we can. And so let's use everything we've got so that at the end of our lives, we're thinking, well, I made the most of that.
Yes, you know? We can. You can. I can. Our listeners can.
And thank you for doing that, Ingrid, because that's what your life has been about and such an inspiration for...
She's still crying. I told you.
Thank you for being on the show. We so appreciate it. And we'd like to have you back.
You.
Okay.
Thank you both very, very much. You're both terrific. Thank you. Love the show.
All right. Have a good evening.
So thank you so much for tuning in today. If we helped you in any way, then click the subscribe button and let's keep hanging out together. We have so much more to share with you.
And if you need more information on actually making the switch for good, please visit us at switchforgood.org for loads of info. And you can subscribe to our mailing list where you will receive all sorts of super cool gifts, discount codes to our very fave dairy-free products, and a lifetime of powerful health tips.
So join us on the journey to switch for good. This is the future.